Anybody who's listening to this, who's grieved, knows you have no control when the feelings of grief come. And one of those moments of missing my dad came over me. And I started to tear up, and I thought, Jesus, this cannot happen now. And the grace was, I said, wait a minute. You're about to receive the body and blood of Christ to be, renew your communion with him, the one who looks at you and loves you.
Welcome to the I Am Here podcast, a space to be inspired by stories of men and women who have found in the Eucharist the strength and purpose for their lives. I'm your co-host, Leah Butalid, and I've been gathering stories for IamHere.org.
And I'm Father Mario Amori, a priest of the Archdiocese of Detroit. And today we welcome Monsignor Patrick Halfpenny to share his story.
Welcome, Monsignor.
Thank you.
It's a blessing
to be with you.
We're glad to have you. Thanks for making the time to share your story with us today.
I'm retired. I have nothing but time.
Well, wonderful, wonderful. Monsignor Halfpenny, can you tell us where you're from?
I grew up in Pontiac, Michigan.
Okay.
Was born there at what was then St. Joseph Mercy Hospital. Went to elementary school at St. Michael's, which had a grade school and high school at the time, and then went to the high school seminary here in the Archdiocese and became a diocesan priest. That's a story for another time, why diocesan and not a missionary.
So you are a priest for the Archdiocese of Detroit, and Monsignor, how many years a priest?
48.
Wow.
Congratulations to you.
Thank you.
And tell us a little bit about your time as a priest here in the Archdiocese, your different assignments, and just some of the blessings, maybe.
How long is this podcast supposed to be?
We'll see how
you want
goes.
Me to go through every assignment over the 48 years? I've been an associate pastor in the city of Detroit, Northwest Detroit, Catholic chaplain at a public hospital, the old Grace Northwest. I was a high school chaplain at Bishop Borges High School and worked in communications for the Archdiocese of Detroit under Cardinal Dearden and then Archbishop and later Cardinal Shaka. I was on the faculty at the seminary as director of spiritual formation, first in the college, then in the graduate program, did that for almost 12 years. Was a pastor back out in Pontiac, not at my home parish, the parish where my parents grew up, however, which was then St. Vincent de Paul. Mainly or heavily Hispanic. Back here at the seminary as vice rector and dean of formation. And I went from here to be pastor of St. Paul's in Grosse Pointe Farms. I was there for almost 16 years. And the Archbishop asked me to work in the clergy office. Sometimes I was doing double duty, so I was also vicar for clergy while I was pastor at St. Paul's. I was also editor in chief of the Michigan Catholic when I was pastor at St. Vincent's in Pontiac, and I've been the ecumenical and interfaith officer for the diocese. So, done a few things.
Beautiful life of ministry.
Amazing.
It's been rich.
Yeah, absolutely. Well, Monsignor, I am so inspired by this incredible life that you've lived in this life of service to the Archdiocese here. And that has to, you know, start with a real relationship with Jesus, particularly in the Eucharist. So can we kind of back things up, and can you share some of your earliest memories of the Eucharist?
Sure. We went to Mass as a family, usually 7:30 Mass on Sunday mornings at St. Michael's. My mom, my dad, my older brother Michael, 4 years older than I. One of my earliest memories of being in the church was at communion time. My parents and my brother probably was old enough to have made his first communion. So they went out. I was expected to stay in the pew and behave. I came back, and my mother, I remember I was kneeling next to her. She knelt down and put her elbows on the seat back, the pew, and put her face in her hands. And I was probably 4, and I thought she was crying. And so I tapped her on the arm, and I said, don't cry, Mommy, it'll be okay. And I don't think she laughed, but she shushed me and said, it's all right, it's all right, it's all right. And I just have that first memory associated with Mass and so with the Eucharist is of great reassurance.
Yeah.
And comfort that it was all going to be okay.
Yeah. What a tender little moment that you have, and what a gift to be able to recall that.
After 48 years, I'm happy to be able to recall anything.
No, that's incredible.
Is it okay if we laugh on this?
Absolutely. Laughs are welcome. Yeah. Oh, that's so sweet. Thank you for sharing that.
You're welcome.
That moment.
So, one of the most beautiful parts of priesthood is being able to accompany, especially our little ones, to the sacraments, and especially the sacrament of Holy Communion. And so, over your 48 years of priesthood, as you think about the many First Communions that you've had the privilege to be a part of, what were those moments like for you?
Treasured. Just treasured. First time I was a pastor, and so much more central to things than as an associate, was at St. Vincent's in Pontiac. And I remember processing with the children from the rectory over to the church. It did not begin auspiciously. I was at the end of the procession. The servers were up in front. All the kids were marching under the supervision of their catechists. And I closed the front door of the rectory on my chasuble. So everybody continued in the procession. Oh. I was stuck on the porch.
Oh, no.
It was not an auspicious beginning. But seeing the children come up and varying degrees of awareness, as you might imagine, but the pride of the parents and the happiness of the parents as they watch their sons and daughters receive the body and blood of Christ for the first time, it extremely moving, extremely moving. And then at St. Paul's in Grosse Pointe Farms, we would have three different masses because we had a large elementary school as well as a large religious education program after school. And it was physically taxing, but to see the joy of the families again, it more contagious than any virus that that the enemy can come up with to afflict us. Just wonderful, wonderful. And to know that, that's the beginning. It's not the beginning of the relationship with Jesus, but it's the beginning of the relationship with Jesus in the Eucharist. Mm-hmm. And knowing from my own personal experience the difference that that can make in somebody's life.
Yeah, absolutely.
That was the joy of my life as a pastor.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
As a priest, it's always a real privilege and a blessing to be a part of those days of sacraments, especially First Communion, because probably for all of us, it brings us back to our own First Communion. I remember the white suit that I wore. I remember who was sitting in the pew and the banner that hung on the end of the pew. And it's just always a reminder to me of the importance of revisiting those days and the joy that was a part of them.
Yeah.
And also a conviction to rekindle that joy and that love for the Lord in the Eucharist. And that was always kind of part of my preaching on those days, to be sure that we never lose that joy.
Yeah.
Always go back to it.
Yeah. I remember when we do the catechesis for parents in preparation for First Communion, I used to share with them part of an essay by Ron Hansen, who's a Catholic. I think he's the writer in residence at the Jesuit University of Santa Clara, out in Southern California. And he does exactly what you were describing, remembers his own First Communion as he begins this essay on the Eucharist. And he talks about, he has a twin brother, how they were lined up and they got to lead the procession. And he was kind of afraid, you know, that that the host might not like the taste, or that it would get stuck to the roof of his mouth, and all the things that could go wrong. But he ends the essay by saying he comes back to his place, and he wasn't radically changed, but he knew that Jesus was down in his heart, his imperfect heart, and he says, it was a grace I hadn't imagined. And I think that's a good description of what the reception of the Eucharist, certainly for the first time, and God willing, many times after that, can be like, just beyond our imagination.
Yeah. One thing stands out to me, you mentioned in witnessing little ones receive the Eucharist for the first time, the kind of impact that that has on their families and the parents in particular. And you mentioned that your family, you know, you went to Mass every Sunday as a family. I'd love to hear a little bit more about the impact of your family on your understanding of Jesus' real presence and just your own formation in the faith as a young person, how that helped you develop a relationship with Jesus in the Eucharist.
Okay, yeah. In truth, I don't remember any specific conversations that I had with my mom or dad about that. Just the reverence that I saw in them and the fidelity.
Yeah.
As I look back now as an adult, I'm sort of reading back into it, a little eisegesis, back into the family history. I know that it was their faith, and especially the presence of Christ in the Eucharist, that got them through tough times, the death of their parents, for example. And I can imagine that how significant it was for my mom while my dad was in the Army in the Second World War and over in the Philippines. And she had, at that point, my older brother already, who was a 9 or 10 month old child. And I remember wanting, I don't know that they encouraged me necessarily, but I read it now as wanting to be close, physically close, and that's part of what moved me to become an altar server, even though I had to learn the prayers in Latin in those days, when dinosaurs still roamed the earth. yeah, it was their fidelity that somehow at some level told me something about Christ's fidelity.
Wow. And then, so you mentioned that that gave you this desire to be closer, to eventually become an altar server. And can you speak a little bit about, I'm sure that that had something to do with, you know, you discerning a vocation to the priesthood. Can you share a little bit about the role that the Eucharist played in your discernment of your vocation?
Yes. Our church was open, St. Mike's was open all day long, and going to the Catholic school, occasionally we'd go over and make visits. But also making visits, we were encouraged to make visits apart from school. And there was a tradition back in the preconciliar on Holy Thursday, before there was a Mass of the Lord's Supper and before I knew anything about a chrism Mass, you would go to make visits to three different churches. And remember going with my mom and her mother. My mother was an only child, and after my grandfather died, Ma, as we called her, lived with us. And on Holy Thursdays, and making those visits. As far as I know that it had an influence on my vocation. Part of it was seeing the priests in my parish and how happy they seemed to be with their lives and how central celebrating Mass was for them. I don't know that it was this clearly articulated in my little head, my little pointy head. I might like to do that too. I do remember I didn't pray before the Blessed Sacrament, but I was praying after I came down and took the entrance exams, which was, I thought, pretty exhausting.
Oh.
And going back home, and I thought some of my friends were going to too, but it was one of those things where I stepped forward and nobody else did.
Oh, wow.
After I took the test, one night I'd be praying, oh, please let me be accepted, please let me be accepted. Then the next night I'd pray, oh, please don't let me be accepted, oh. Please don't let me be accepted. So there was some mixture. Mm. But when I got here in the high school seminary, and we would have a holy hour every week, and of course Mass was the high point, mm-hmm. but that holy hour before the Blessed Sacrament was, again, there was a reassurance that I was in the right place, that this is where Jesus wanted me.
Wow.
As you think about your time in the seminary, and then your transition from the seminary into priestly ministry, and then even to today, as you think about just your own personal prayer and reliance upon that time in front of the Blessed Sacrament, can you just speak about the importance of that time?
Sure. I want to start by telling a story. This was about 8 years ago, because I think it was around my 40th anniversary. I decided I wanted to make a 8-day directed retreat. I hadn't done it for a while. So I went to a Jesuit retreat center out in Pennsylvania, and had a Jesuit priest who was my director, and things were going pretty well. I think it was maybe the third day, and Jack, the priest, gave me a sheet and said, this is one of St. Ignatius's footnotes. He said, you may be familiar with this. I'd never seen it before. I'd done the spiritual exercises, but this is one of St. Ignatius's footnotes to the spiritual exercises. And what St. Ignatius directs the person to do, the retreatant, is to go, he says, go to the place where you usually pray. And before you, about 10 feet away from the spot where you usually sit or kneel, stop. Close your eyes. And for about the length of time that it would take you to say the Lord's Prayer, imagine Jesus standing there, looking at you and loving you. So I said, okay. And there was an older chapel. This was an old Jesuit formation house. And they had a more contemporary chapel down in the basement. But I liked this place because there were lots of other people on retreat as well, but this was usually pretty quiet. So I walked down the center aisle, this old, looks something like the chapel at the Sacred Heart, and about 10 feet away from the front pew where I usually sat, I stopped and I closed my eyes and imagined Jesus standing in front of the altar, looking at me and loving me. And I started to weep. I was just overwhelmed in that moment with his love, and that was the grace of the retreat. And I think that's how I describe the Eucharist. He's there, he's looking at me, and he's loving me. Not because I do everything right, which I don't, not because I'm the best priest, because I'm not, but just because he chooses to love me. That sums up the Eucharist for me.
That's beautiful. Thank you for taking us back to that moment. That's incredibly powerful. So thinking about your life as a priest, I'm sure you've had, you know, several moments like that, but I'm sure there's also the day-to-day of just, you know, not necessarily these great intimate moments of consolation with the Lord. How were you drawn back into that intimacy? How did Jesus bring you back to that over time, you know, throughout your ministry as a priest and just throughout your day-to-day life?
Sure. As you can imagine, there was a phrase that we had to learn freshman year of high school in Latin class, repetitio est mater studiorum. Repetition is the mother of wisdom. Don't ask me for much more Latin than that, please. The purpose of ritual, as I understand it, is to free us up, heart and mind, so that we can praise and glorify God and be drawn closer to Him. The risk of ritual, and where the enemy sometimes gets in the life at least of this priest, it probably doesn't happen to any other priest, you can almost start taking things for granted. And I remember this was shortly after I got to St. Paul's, and we had a 6:30 weekday mass. And full disclosure, I'm not at my best at 6:30 in the morning.
Neither am I.
And so I'm coming down the steps, and mercifully the rectory at St. Paul's is connected to the church, beautiful old church built in 1897. So I'm coming down the steps from my room, and I don't think I was praying, but I was sort of complaining in my heart about having to be up at 6 o'clock, going down steps, and close the door behind me, connecting between the church and the rectory. And there are three steps going down to the sacristy, and I was on the second step, and I had one of those moments. And Jesus said, "Remember what you are about to do." And I froze in mid-step. And then I went down to the sacristy and got vested and celebrated Mass. I don't remember that experience every time that I celebrate Mass, but I do it enough times that I'm still grateful for it, that I remember what I'm about to do, what really He's about to do through me. Mm-hmm. And that makes a great difference.
Mm-hmm. Monsignor, when you encounter difficulties, or when you encounter just the hardships of life, as everyone does, you mentioned in your story just the time after your dad passed away, and you were just kind of overcome with emotion during the celebration of Mass because of just a really beautiful grace that you received. Can you tell us a little bit about that moment? And then also, in the life of the priest, you know, many times people don't always agree with decisions that are made. Or
really?
I'm really shocked. Or, you know, people always have, you know, different... different ideas of what should be done or not. Just some insight into those moments as well and the power of just bringing yourself before the Lord in the Blessed Sacrament.
Yeah, sure. I'm glad that we're starting with the first thing. Mm-hmm. It was a few weeks after my dad died, and I had read this book by Joan Didion when her husband died suddenly. And the one thing that I took away from it, the book is called... The Year of Magical Thinking. And she said, grief is like you're standing in the ocean and you're braced for the waves as they come, but every once in a while a rogue wave comes and it just knocks you off your feet. She said, that's what grief is like. And I was celebrating Mass, we'd said the Lord's Prayer, and you have no control. Anybody who's listening to this who's grieved knows you have no control when the feelings of grief come. And one of those moments of missing my dad came over me. And I started to tear up, and I thought, Jesus, this cannot happen now. And the grace was, I said, wait a minute. You're about to receive the body and blood of Christ to be... renew your communion with Him, the one who looks at you and loves you. Your father My dad was a fine, fine man. Deep faith, dedicated husband and father. Said, your father's in communion with Christ. So if I'm in communion with Christ and he's in communion with Christ, I'm in communion with my dad at this moment when I receive the body and blood of Jesus. And so I went on with the Mass and distributed communion and dried my tears, and all was well. For the second question, yes, people do not always agree. And sometimes, as a priest in solidum or pastor, whatever the title, shepherd, father of the family, you have to make some decisions that are difficult decisions. And it may be possible to make those without being rooted in Christ in the Eucharist. I don't know. I'm glad I don't have to find out, because I believe I am rooted in Christ, especially in the Eucharist. And it doesn't make the pain necessarily less, because we like everybody to get along, you know, share all the toys in the sandbox and don't throw the sand at one another. But it doesn't always work out that way. But knowing that Christ is with me and I am in Christ, you know, he says, my yoke is easy, my burden's light. Sometimes it's pretty heavy. But what I have to remember is that there's never just one opening in a yoke. Monsignor Bill Easton reminded me of this one time when we were in the Holy Land in a homily. He preached to the seminarians. I don't remember where we were. But Jesus is always yoked with me. And I grew up in Pontiac. We didn't have a lot of oxen. I had aunts who had farms, but they didn't have oxen either. But the stronger ox is always the one I believe it's on the inside, and he does the heavier work. So Jesus is the one who's doing the heavier work. I let him do that, and he'll give me what I need to do whatever I have to lift, whatever I have to carry, whatever I have to pull.
I so appreciate both of those reflections, especially it's kind of the way you've understood processing grief in the context of the Eucharist. That's such a gift, I think, for me personally, and for anyone who has is grieving, has grieved, will grieve. So thank you so much for sharing that. I would love to know, in your day-to-day life now, and just with this, you've shared some beautiful moments with Jesus in the Eucharist. How is your time spent with Jesus in the Eucharist now, whether that's, you know, in before the Blessed Sacrament, in a holy hour? How do you spend that time? What do you like to make of that time spent with him?
Okay. There are two pieces. The first is, because I'm living on my own, I don't have easy access to the Eucharist, to the Eucharistic presence, except when I celebrate Mass, which I continue to do every day. People say, do you have to celebrate Mass every day now that you're retired? And I like to respond, I get to celebrate Mass every day. It's a privilege and a blessing. And but in my prayer time in the morning, I depend more on the Word, since I don't have the Eucharistic presence reserved in my home. But another thing that's a source of sustenance for me over the years has been my participation in a group of priests that gets together monthly. We started a month after I was ordained, so we've been doing this for about 48 years. Bishop Don Hanschen, Father Ron DeHunt, Father Ed Farrell was instrumental in helping us start this. He's gone home to God. Father Paul Letterman's gone home to God. Father Ted Parker, Archbishop John Neinstedt, who's retired, and Father Mike Molnar. I think I got everybody in the saints. But once a month, we get together, and we always begin with an hour of adoration before we get together to share what we call our review of life, where the grace is challenging or easier. Beginning together, actually, tomorrow evening and Thursday, about three times a year, we get together for an overnight and do that. So that's one way that I stay, apart, in addition to Mass, connected to the Eucharist.
Mm-hmm. And Monsignor, we're in the midst of Eucharistic revival right now.
Yeah.
And should continue to be beyond the next year. Just Eucharistic revival should always be at the heart of who we are and what we do. So what do you think? What do you think needs to be central for Eucharistic revival in our church?
I agree with you. People couldn't see me shaking my head. But I agree that the revival needs to continue well beyond the conclusion next summer with the
Congress.
Eucharistic Congress, thank you. Excellent memory, just this long. I think, and this is what I used to encourage people who would come saying that they were concerned because their adult children were not coming to Mass. I remember a couple times at least I preached about this. I said, be ready to tell people in 90 seconds why you're here. I think we need people to be willing to testify about the significance of the Eucharist in their lives, how being close to Christ in the Eucharist helps them. Not you should do this, but I'm here because I want to so badly I have to. And the other thing is continuing prayer, especially prayer before the Eucharist, when possible, but prayer anyhow. Never let the perfect get in the way of the good. So prayer that family members, neighbors, co-workers, whoever it happens to be, that person or those people will be so hungry for the body and blood of Jesus that nothing can keep them away. Not a sale at Walmart's, not a Little League game, not a Lions game, whatever it happens to be. So prayer for hunger for the Eucharist and my testimony, this is why I'm here. I had a nephew, a great nephew actually, who made his first communion this past spring out of state, and I went down. And I remember writing in the card that I gave him something like a part of my testimony. I said, anything that you see in me that you think is decent or good or that you like is because of my relationship with Jesus Christ. And especially that relationship with him in the Eucharist.
That's powerful. Thank you so much for highlighting both of those components. I think with the work that we're doing here with I Am Here, the idea of personal testimony to what Jesus has done in our lives is something we can all agree is going to aid this season of revival. So thank you for doing that very thing, for sharing your story, witnessing to what Jesus has done in your life, and allowing that good news to, you know, impact those who have read your story online and those who are listening to this podcast today. So thank you so much, Monsignor Halfpenny, for joining us and for sharing, witnessing to what Jesus has done in your life through his presence in the Eucharist.
You're most welcome. God bless you. Thank you for what you're doing.
Thank you for listening to the I Am Here podcast. You can read and listen to more stories of people encountering Jesus in the Eucharist at iamhere.org. And we also invite you to share your story with us. I Am Here is a campaign by the Archdiocese of Detroit and Halo app in support of the National Eucharistic Revival.